Okay, thank you for being here and not going to swim today. It's not. So, of course, I would like also to thank our main organizer, which is Thomas. And you know, this is the 10th edition. There are 20 years he's doing this for us. Anyway, thank you, Thomas. So, you had already so much about the neutrinos, and this is one more, one more little consideration, because now in Salerno neutrinos are our toys. you see, quantum field theory is a teenage theory in many sense, in many ways. So the idea is to see how far from a rich paradigm we are when we talk about mixing of neutrinos and oscillations, of course. You had already even too much introductions about neutrinos, so I might skip this, except that I would like to call your attention on the fact that related research with this neutrino mixing has been also in connection with the quantum gravity fluctuations and things like that. So this argument about the neutrinos is widening more and more in time. But in any case, let me go in the middle. It looks like that we can write things in such a way a non-abelian gauge structure appears when you deal with neutrino mixing. How you do that? In a very simple way. You consider the Lagrangian in the flower neutrinos basis, and everything is specified on this slide. Oh, sorry. M is this matrix, so you have also this M in U. They are the two usual standard objects you have in the, when you start to consider neutrino mixing, so everything is completed, there is nothing. Except the fact that when you write the field equations derived in the traditional way from this Lagrangian, you get these two guys here. Now, this part looks very much like an interaction of neutrinos with some source. If this would be electrodynamics, you would have electron interacting with the gauge field. So the idea is to say, well, I do not read very well because I'm quite old, so I do what I would be doing with electrons and A nu, if you want, and then I take this part and I bring on the other side here, and then by using the standard sigma, Pauli, and beta, and so on, I write those equations in a much compact form, where now, instead of this time derivative, you have the covariant time derivative here. This part is the same, except that here now this MD is only the diagonal part of that matrix that you had before, is up here. And P0 is the time derivative, and then this part, the sigma 1, is there because in the original one, if I know how to go back, you had, you see, in the equation for, in the equation for ni, you had ni nu, and for ni nu, you had ni, so you need that sigma 1, which is there. So once you have done this game, you might rename things, and then m in nu becomes this quantity. And now delta m is the difference, the mass difference between these two. You might write things in a standard way, and you find that the only a nu playing such kind of a role is the temporal component only time, in space time, and only the first component in the SU2 space. So this is quite simple. Nevertheless, it's a non-abelian gauge theory. Of course, you write at this point in this notation you have d nu, but you know that this nu is actually d0, but it's just for convenience you write it that way.
And the other questions
came up. Your Lagrangian is written again in that way. And since the only object which is non-zero is a mu with a mu equal to zero, you find f mu nu completely is zero. So this is a case which is quite near. You have a gauge potential, but you do not have a gauge field. So it's quite near to von Mahalanoff frame and effect. Then you do just standard things. You write down the energy momentum tensor for this kind of writing, and you find that this quantity. Everything of this is quite a simple exercise in some sense, not sorry to mention. And then you also look for the difference between what would be the theory without such a gauge business involved and the standard way of doing it. So this is T for standard way. In fact, you have this term, which is the only difference between the two T. This T with the gauge behavior, I put a tilde. Yes, I put a tilde on the top, and so the difference between the two is just the mixing part. The terms responsible of mixing and the analytic oscillation, of course. And one important point is that since in D0 there is this part, and the commutators with gamma mu is non-zero. And this means that such energy momentum tensor for such part of it is not considered, is not zero. Without mixing term, the covariant derivative would have been conserved. But this term, which is there indeed, forbids such a kind of situation. So at this point, you write down for momentum P, the PI and the P0, and in the usual way, and you split, you see that each one of those split into two pieces, one for the electron and the other one for the muon flower. Here I'm considering these two neutrinos scheme, but you can do generalizing things also for three, of course. But the important point here is that we succeeded to separate the two flower component in this tilde object. You can write also the other generators, and you recover the Lorentz covariance, the Lorentz group. The point is that Massimo and Gaetano, they were stressing, is the fact that once you have the mixing of two massive objects with different masses, then the object you get is no more irreducible, describable as an irreducible representation of the Poincaré group. So you have lost the best of the story in the quantum field theory. So we try to recover that part. But what happens? It happens that such a Poincaré structure that you have now I will tell you, I'm anticipating, is a Poincaré structure at each time t. So at each time you have it different. It is like you are on a tangent space to some curve in the background, and at each time, along this tangent, at this tangent space, you find the usual Poincaré structure. So, to see how this can happen, this is a little bit formal. You write your neutrino field in this new basis with this tilde objects, which I will tell you how you will recover. This is U and V, and now solve the equation. You see, here you have M sigma. Sigma is E or mu. So you recover it as some kind of a massive description also for the flower neutrino. Please remember that flower neutrino are not any state of mass operator. This was missing from the very structure. But now, in this framework, you might write in this way again, and then those tilde operators, af and eta operators and annihilation operators, are obtained from the mixed ones, originally mixed ones, through such the generator, which is written here, which is a Bobolimbov generator. So you are moving to a new representation with such a Bobolimbov generator. And in fact, your vacuum, the flower and the vacuum at quantum Massimo and Betano were using in the previous talk, is again transformed by such a J, by such a generator, and you get this new, even new, and so tilde one, state, which is a vacuum state. But this vacuum state is, again, remember, if you want, the condensate, which is here. And just this slice you have seen already, Massimo did show you, this is the flower vacuum, where you find this, all this complex structure with two neutrino and a neutrino, but dagar, and all this structure in the original vacuum of massive 1-2 neutrinos. So this is the vacuum on which you did operate with such a J that was in the previous slide. And this slide already Massimo did show you, so I don't insist, but this is a very important slide because people considering the neutrino mixing in oscillation, they do not vacuum usually to do the real computation when you do a field, not just a state, but you are in quantum field theory because the neutrinos are fields. You are doing standard model if you want. And you have to use fields. If you use fields and a piece of paper, and then you can do computation and you find such a nested relation. And you have a Bobolimbov transformed objects inside a rotation structure. And Massimo did show you how you have such a kind, how this kind of structure arises in this G operator, which creates such a mixing. But I do not spend more on these formal aspects. Of course, you might compute also in this new frame I'm operating, this gauge-like structure, the charge of the system. So you have the flower charge and the nether charge, and all of it amounts to write again these tilde objects which you derive. You see, this charge cannot be reduced to the usual nether charge because there is such a mixing part. So that is still there making the job. Please tell me when. So you have everything you need to do just normal field theory. And at the end, you find also a structure which is a diagonal structure for your four momenta. This is tilde momenta. You see, this is a tilde, this is a diagonal. So you can define common eigenstates. And this is, in some sense, the end of the story. You did solve the problem to provide a would be, with quotation mark, because we have been constructing it, it would be irreducible representation of fourth flowered neutrinos. With the carefulness, you have to be careful, because such a representation, as you see, is different for at each time, x and zero. So you are in such a kind of a tangent space. Of course, you can work out all the usual details, and you have the Poincaré structure in some sense, in the sense I'm saying. Flower neutrinos, they behave locally in time as ordinary on-shell fields with definite masses, M, E, and M, U. rather than those of the mass instead of the standard approach M1 and M2. Now there is an interesting observation, I mean interesting at least for me, I don't know for you, but I like because you see, if you look at the shape of this H tilde I gave you before, and you consider the difference between H and H tilde, this H tilde is like a kind of a free energy. In fact, that difference is, you can write like T times S. S is the entropy, and if you work out the computation just by using the what I gave you on this slide before, S is given by this part, namely by this delta M, which is the difference of the flowered mass, please remember, and the mixing term. So the mixing term, and this agrees with the picture that Massimo was giving to you since the beginning, with this entropy description of the flower mixing and so on. So we are again, with respect to other problems, watching at the gauge field like a reservoir. Because after all, the gauge field in normal QED, if you want, the seamless phase, operates in such a way to compensate the local phase transformation. This is a reservoir. So if you want, this is, this is the end of the story. But now you have also the possibility to compute the correlation coefficient, usually called J, on this state, the flowered ground state, which is, by adopting the usual definition in notation, this is covariance, which is the difference between these things. And you find that this is zero for those operators appearing, for those neutrinos appearing in the condensate of the same name, let's say, either alto, I mean, alpha and alpha, alto with I and J, 1, 2, equal or different, doesn't matter. But if you look for the other couples, you find that this J is non-zero. Is non-zero. So they are a number. This is the usual way you check if the state you are dealing with is an entangled state or not. And this is different from zero. And if you look at alpha and beta with the same I and J different, I mean, and then you find this one, which is again different from zero. So the flowered state is an entangled state over M1 and M2. Which is the real meaning of a mixing. Otherwise, which kind of mixing? If you put coffee in the milk, and then you can separate the milk, not the cappuccino. It's not good, the cappuccino. So this is entangled. Now, we have a possibility, but I will not tell you anything about that, because the time is gone, to represent all of this like a propagation in a medium with a refractive index, which is different for different neutrinos, for different flowers. You can do the simple computation you do in such a case by defining N1 and N2 are different refraction index, and you can work out all everything in a very easy way. I mean, there is nothing more than you can read on this slide, and you see that what was the contribution to the gauge structure, which is here, can indeed because the refraction index are different for these two flowered neutrinos. If they were the same, this would be zero. There would be no gauge, which means omega 1 is equal to omega 2, which means you do not have even mixing. So mixing is also, can be seen, mixing and all this gauge structure can be seen as the reaction to, the reaction to propagation of one neutrino in the field of the other one, because this was the gauge field. And this is quite interesting because the ontological prejudice that things exist by themselves, like scattered bits of broken glass, should be broken. in physics we do today. What happens is that you have objective modes of correlated objects. Thank you.
Some time for a few questions.
Thank you, it's very interesting. So if you took all the three flavors oscillations together and not just two, do you have a SU3 gauge group?
Yes, probably SU3. SU3.
Yes, so just a naive question, is this then a new interaction in nature which we should search for beyond the standard?
Yes, I understand you, but it's not the old eightfold way. I mean, it's a completely different.
So there's a new SU3 something?
It's an SU3 due to three kind of flavors you have.
Yeah,
why you have just three?
Question. When quantized, it has gauge bosons which we should look for in the lab?
If you want, each one is a gauge field for the other one. If you break such a gauge symmetry, this is, by the way, there is a breakdown because the vacuum is not invalid under the generator of such a gauge. Mm. So this is another cover, let's say, one more gauge cover you have on the usual standard model. Which is, in some sense, quite nice, because it's the gauge paradigm, which...
I agree with you.
This is why it is a toy. I mean, we enjoy doing this, and we are excited that we start to work on the neutrinos.
Thank you for the good talk. Is the entropy you found equal to the entanglement entropy? Can we say this?
That one of the massive includes the entropy about, between these two different quantum numbers. This is entropy due to mixing of two different
flavors.
Yes,
massive entropy in flavor space, in a sense.
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
I see. I was wondering if they are the good. Okay, thank you. They are the good.
So, if no more question.
Thank you for the talk. Just one curiosity. This, because this polarization and that stuff has something to do, you can import, let's say, some methods from the theta vacuum, like the theta vacuum.
If you want, yes, because it is a parametrization of the unitary non-equivalent representation, in this case by time, which is in some sense nice. At first talk we had by the Bianchi or the Bianchi was instantaneity, teach instant you are on a different representation. I do not want to take, but there is an observation related to this. Since such states, the vacuum of such state at each time are coherent states, and under the coherent state, which by the way are also squeezed states. Yesterday there was Vitaliano which gave us a beautiful talk about the squeezing and entanglement. There is a theorem of Taylor saying that the manifold of coherent states is a symmetric manifold, which means you might have classical trajectories. And these trajectories, in this case, you can show they are chaotic trajectories, namely very much sensible to very tiny change in the initial conditions, which makes all of it even more nasty. If it is true, we do not care very much. We enjoy it.
So let us thank speaker again.